Good evening. The March 15th Board of Education meeting is now in session. Please rise for the invocation. O God, we pray to administer that which is just in all educational policies. Being ever mindful of your guidance, stir us to action with love, wisdom, and understanding. The pledge.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible,
Item 2.03 is approval of the minutes. Do I have a motion to approve the minutes?
So moved. Second.
All those in favor? The minutes are approved. Item 2.04 is establish agenda order, and the agenda stands as published. Item 2.05 was going to be a recognition, but our recognition folks were not able to make it tonight, so we will save that for later. And item 2.06, school and community highlights. Mrs. Hummer.
Last week was Read Across America Week, Dr. Seuss Day, which is always great fun across the county. And I have the pleasure of reading at Monarch Global and at the Annapolis Library with students from Tyler Heights, and that was great fun. That's always a fun week for the schools. Also, several of us attended the Shipley's Choice Blue Ribbon School Celebration, and it was very impressive. Every school should go and see how polite they were during the assembly, because they were just great. And they had a very impressive bunch who were showing off and telling us about their clubs and things. And the ones who were telling me about the terrapins I want to bring home with me, because they were so darling. And then Saturday night, Ms. Sasso and I attended the Arts Council of Anne Arundel Arts Gala, and the Arts Council is a huge supporter of our schools and provides tens of thousands of dollars worth of grants to help bring artists to our schools each year, so it was a pleasure to attend their gala and help them raise funds for the coming year. So.
And Dr. Oletto and Mrs. Hummer and I were also at the Blue Ribbon Celebration Dinner, so we've been celebrating Shipley's Choice all week, and the Rock and Roll Revival at Severna Park High School in their new auditorium was just fantastic. I think some of us have gone the first weekend and some more are going next weekend.
Good evening, President Korbelak, Dr. Arlotto, and other members of the board. My name is Christina Dyson, and I am the Secretary of Education for the Chesapeake Regional Association of Student Councils. At our General Assembly on February 17th, we updated our Constitution to align with the current structure and activities of our organization. This was the first major revision in a very long time, and quite frankly, it was long overdue. Our biggest change was changing the titles of the offices from First Vice President to the Secretary of Legislation, Second Vice President, my position, to the Secretary of Education, Treasurer to the Secretary of Service, and the Secretary to the Secretary of Communication. We also added the position of Vice President, but Middle School Coordinator remains the same. This was done to encourage a student to run for the appropriate office based on what that office does, instead of the office as perceived by the highest ranking. Another important change was to add the following phrasing. The organization is coordinated through the Office of Student Leadership, but stances, policies, and initiatives do not reflect the positions or opinions of the superintendent, AACBS staff, or Board of Education. This was done especially to ensure that CRASC is not perceived as an agent of AACBS, especially when we address a controversial issue to the public eye. Our primary focus is representing the students, not necessarily anyone else. Nominations for student board member remain open until this Friday, March 17th, and we are excited to meet the new team of emerging student leaders. A number of them are joining us for this evening's meeting. And finally, we'd like to thank you and all of your support in our legislative advocacy this year. At this point, all amendments to revoke the student board member voting rights have been rejected or withdrawn. We'd especially like to thank Mr. Mosier, Jeanette Ortiz, and Tyson Bennett for their support and guidance in this process. Thank you for allowing me to represent the students of Anne Arundel County.
Thank you. The next item on our agenda is public participation. Anyone wishing to speak on an item not on today's agenda may offer testimony during the public comment portion. Speakers will be allotted 3 minutes each, and the board asks that comments remain civil and appropriate for the various audiences that may be watching or viewing the meeting. Student-specific and personnel matters are confidential and cannot be discussed in this forum. This time is intended for speakers to voice their opinion and not necessarily as a question and answer period. Speakers may pose questions, but answers will be counted toward the 3 minute allotment. For the record, please give your name before speaking, and handouts should be given to the board assistant. I have 7 cards, so I'll call up 5. Robert Silkworth, Robert Eads, Sandra Johnson, Eva Reynolds, Don Zebron.
Good evening, President Korblak, Vice President Hummer, other distinguished board members, Dr. Alada, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Robert Silkworth, and I'm here this evening as the chairperson of the High School Concerns Committee. Although we have not been able to testify over the past few months because of the day meetings, we have continued to meet and to collaborate with Dr. McMahon and Dr. Kubik on the ASI TAC Advisory Council. Just a few highlights. We were very pleased when we learned that a request was made to add some additional funding to the budget request for additional compensation for teachers, perhaps mid-year. This was clearly, in our minds, a positive step, and we believe an important step. We do thank you for that, and we will, of course, continue to advocate for the funding of the budget, and we hope that a satisfactory agreement can and will be reached through the bargaining process. The last time we testified, we did discuss the issue of safe schools, as well as the issue of respect. We continue to believe that the Anne Arundel County Board of Education campaign, Be Nice, should be modified to include a Be Respectful component of some kind. There are still some concerns in some of our schools about safety issues and respect issues. However, the good news is these concerns are being addressed when they are brought to the attention of the appropriate staff, and we do greatly appreciate the help that has already been provided in that regard. Through the ASI TAC Advisory Group collaboration, we have discussed issues such as co-teachers, access to grade books, department chair observations, and special ed, regular ed co-teaching model concerns, as well as concerns about quarterly assessments, including the scheduling of these assessments. Some changes have, in fact, been made recently based upon these collaborative efforts, and we do thank Dr. McMahon and Dr. Kubik and their staffs for the help and their willingness always to listen. You will be receiving minutes for the recent High School Concerns meeting tomorrow via email, and our next meeting will be held on April 19, 2017 at 3:40 p.m. in the TAC office, and everyone, of course, is welcome. I usually try to end, as you know, with some kudos. On the side, I would like to say that I was very glad to hear about the recent testimony from the student government. The student board member is such an important person and has been for many, many, many years, and so I was glad to hear that news. The kudos, however, going out to the folks that are nominees for Anne Arundel County Teachers of the Year: Joshua Carroll from South River, Sally Wilson, Tyler Heights Elementary, Stacy Schofield, Mills Pearl Elementary, Timothy Smith, Folger McKenzie Elementary, and Denise Stefanos from Arundel High School, as well as the two county independent schools, Deborah Flynn and Kelly Rantmeyer. Thank you so much, and I'm sorry I couldn't do any singing, folks. That's not for me, so thank you. But it was good, and I would advise everyone not only to go to see that, but at North County High School in April, there we're Our drama department is also putting on a musical production. I believe it's going to be The Little Mermaid and Fantastic.
Good evening. My name is Robert Eads. I'm resident of Annapolis City, 32 Pleasant Street. Mrs. President, Mrs. Vice President, Dr. Alado, did I pronounce that right? Good. Sorry I haven't got a chance to meet you, but I knew every superintendent since Ms. Parham, Mr. Smith, Mr. Maxwell. I all had a good working relationship with all of them. But I'm here this evening as a failed product of the public school system. The public school system failed me miserably, although I did get some education from one of the state's worst schools, State Penn. But for the last 20-some years, I've been known as a community activist around Annapolis. I boast of some 20-some children that I got working jobs from school teachers, working at the social service department, a couple of them working at the Pentagon, a couple of them doing regular jobs as managing Burger King's, McDonald's. And the reason why I'm here this evening is to speak about the community ambassadors. If there had been community ambassadors, I think my life would have been a lot different. Because as I deal with these young kids in and out of the neighborhood, in and out of, I have a program called Neat and Clean's Boys Girl Club. I started myself, I funded myself. And when I get children to a certain level that I can't handle, I turn them on to these community ambassadors. I think that the community ambassadors should get a little more respect for what they do. I think maybe they should be looked at as having a program that actually funds them, pays them, because if you go out and you, say, for instance, start another program and go another way and bring in some bookworms and some college guys, they can't reach the parents. They can't reach the children because they don't know the infrastructure of the communities. They don't know what it takes to talk to people in our community, in my community speaking. I can't speak for everybody else around the whole county, but I'm quite sure it's the same story because each ambassador that I know comes from the neighborhood. They can go to the parents and say, look, your child ain't doing, they can talk a certain way whereas somebody with an education, with a degree, wouldn't be able to go into that house and talk to the parent that way. And I'm saying that the ambassador program is very important within my community. I think the ambassadors should be respected, looked upon as some real hardworking people, and that they should maybe get put on staff or whatever you would call it, whereas though they can really make a living and do a pay and show you what they can produce. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Sandra Johnson. I've been working with children for a very long time. I'm actually working with the Annapolis Housing Authority at the Eastport Recreation Center. I am one of those community ambassadors that everyone is speaking about. I am proud to be a community ambassador. I enjoy working with our children at AHI. I think that being there has done a great deal of help to the children and the staff there. You know, we all get along. We depend on each other to work with the kids, especially children who have low attendance, kids who have low grades. Excuse me, my mouth is getting kind of dry. I have a cold, but I'm here to just speak out. I'm a little nervous, but I'm going to say what I truly, truly feel from my heart when it comes to working with the children at Annapolis High. It's every child there that needs us, and every child there is so funny that comes to us and needs some type of help. And we reach out and we help them. Whether it's to, sometimes we have to take them home, you know, when they've gotten in trouble. A lot of times we go to the neighborhood and interact with the parents and, you know, getting information. There are kids that we have to just constantly talk to all the time, you know. And it's a hard a hard knock. You know, you may be telling that same kid every day, don't walk the halls, don't walk the halls. One day that kid gonna go to class. And most of the time they listen to us when we tell them they have to be in class. We sit in classrooms sometimes. Some of the teachers don't mind it because I guess they feel like that's a help to them. But I honestly want to say that being a community ambassador at that school has been a joy for me. I mean, you know, sure, we need to be recognized more. We need to have more money. We need to be permanent. However, you all may be looking at these community, us as community ambassadors. We've been working with them. I've been working with them for like, off and on for like 7 years. So I know a lot of kids and a lot of children know me. And I'm well liked by them. So, you know, they come look for us. We look for them. So it's like, you know, when you reach out and parents know that they got somebody there that they can contact and say, Miss, they affectionately know me by Miss Tippy. They know that if I'm in that school, if they okay, check with Miss Tippy. She'll make sure you get or what you need or bring you home or whatever. So today I'm just here just to tell you that it's a great program. And I hope you all look at it very deeply that, you know, it shall not be removed. Thank you.
Thank you for your advocacy.
Hi, I'm Eva Reynolds. I currently have 4 students in the county schools, and I'm the current PTA president at Chesapeake Bay Middle School. Good evening to the board and Dr. Arlotto. Nice to see you all again. I'm here to deliver a petition signed by our Chesapeake Cluster community affecting children pre-K through high school. In just 2 weeks, we have almost 1,000 Severna Park and Pasadena residents' signatures collected. Every day, we're getting more. This petition is asking for clear and clean water in our Chesapeake schools. I send my children to school every day with at least 1 bottle of water. I know not everyone in the building has that option, and this is their option for water at the schools. I think it's unacceptable. I think it would be unacceptable to go in a restaurant and get a bottle of water like that or be served water like that, so I don't understand why it's acceptable in our schools. Personally, I can only attest to the past 2 years about the water issue, but as I speak with more people in the community, I've discovered this year's issue has been a problematic for many, many, many years. The school is 40 years old, the complex at Chesapeake. We realize it is complicated. We realize it's been tested, and we realize solutions are very expensive. But we also realize it's warm, it's brown, it has floaters, as the students say. Visiting sports teams the coaches will not use the water at the cluster because they refuse to refill their coolers there. They all know it's just an unwritten rule. The kids that are old enough to make a decision will not drink this water. The kids who are too little to make a decision will. And I really don't know which is worse. I do know that our PTA has supplemented the bottled water supply. We've paid for clean water so that our kids don't come home complaining of headaches, so they actually hydrate before and after gym class, and so they can concentrate on their studies instead of being distracted by thirst. Tonight, we're here to ask you, Dr. Arlotto, and the board to look again at this issue. Give us something more than what we have already been given. Don't give us the water quality test results that say the water falls within acceptable ranges. Don't tell us the system just needs to be flushed out one more time. Don't give us the reports from MES and the facilities managers that say the water is safe to drink. It's dirty. It looks dirty. It's not palatable. It's not clean in the simplest sense of the word. We want clean and clear drinking water for our approximately 3,400 students and staff members within the complex. The flushing, the testing, the reports have all been done, and we still have brown water. Until a final solution is determined, we request bottled water coolers for the schools. Please give our kids clean water. Give us a stipend per school to provide bottled water to our Chesapeake students. We're simply asking to bring the Chesapeake cluster up to the standards that other schools in this county are afforded as a matter of course. Thank you.
Mr. Grannon.
That report actually says that the water in that bottle, just like that, is safe and fine to drink. Does it note any deficiencies whatsoever in the testing?
I'm not a chemical expert. There's some issues with the chlorine and the lead in this, but this, what?
Let me just to correct this. So there aren't issues with chlorine or lead.
Just from the layperson looking at it.
Right. No, I just, and I, because it's a good question, there are issues with iron, right? Because this is well water. So we've got 20 facilities, 18 schools, and our Fort Smallwood Center and Arlington Echo that are on well water. And so it's the iron. So it's not a lead issue, it is not a chlorine issue, it's not a pH issue. And in fact, they are testing. She's absolutely right. They are testing, have tested for years that it is safe to drink. It's potable water. There's a difference between the aesthetic and the safety. And you're absolutely right. No, I don't disagree with you at all. But it is tested three times. It's tested three times a week. We have an outside agency that does that, so it's not us doing the work. It's the Maryland Environmental Service, I think, is Maryland MES, Maryland Environmental Service. We actually have a water filtration system at the Chesapeake Complex that pulls the water from the well and cleans it, and that's all done through MES. That's not done from our folks. In terms of response,
MES's contractor, Martell.
Right. And so there was a meeting this past Friday with our team, our engineers, and our plumbers, along with MES, to see what can we be doing to correct this, because it needs to be corrected. There's no question. The water doesn't run like that every day, all day. I went out this past Friday. And I visited all three buildings. I met with the principals, the business manager, the high school. I went to several sinks, toilets, and water fountains. I drank from the water fountains, and it was running clear. I checked with the schools today. It was running clear today. It many times happens when the water has settled over a weekend, and Mondays are a time where it's worse, and it tends to get better over, is what I'm told from the school. Because I wanted to hear from the school personnel directly. I went out this past Friday and met with them in the afternoon, and it tends to get better over time during the course of a week. So we have some things that MES has asked us to do and install in the pipes, and those are processes. We started some processes yesterday. The bad news, we were closed, but the good news was we could get some of our team into those buildings yesterday to try some things with our pipes. It seemed to be running. They were hopeful that this might correct it. I can't guarantee that it is, and nor can they at this time, but we're going to go through these new processes that have been worked through with the engineers and MES and see if this clears it up. Clears up.
But the principal,
no pun intended.
The principal issue is at times there's just too much iron in the water because it's well water.
Correct, and it does come out discolored like that. Absolutely.
Right. Okay.
And it's not, and as she absolutely stated correctly, it's not a new issue, and that section of Pasadena, that section of Mountain Road, is on well water.
Okay. Thank you.
Yes, sir.
Members of the board, my name is Dawn Zebron, and I initiated the petition for clean and clear drinking water for our students and staff in the Chesapeake Cluster of Schools after volunteering at the school for our Show You Care event in February. I remember looking at the empty water coolers PTA initially funded due to our water concerns and thinking, how can I sit here trying to show I care about our students in school, yet the water coolers are empty and the only other readily available water to our children and staff is brown. Every article I've read during my research discusses the importance of water to human life. The National Institute of Health Water Hydration and Health article discusses how even mild dehydration affects cognitive functioning, alertness, short-term memory, as well as affecting other systems in the body like GI and cardiovascular. Children are at greater risk for voluntary dehydration. They may not recognize the need to replace fluids when they are active during the day. The CDC increasing access to drinking water in schools recommends not only access to safe, but to clean, palatable drinking water, too. The United Nations Decade for Action article defines acceptable water as acceptable in color, odor, and taste by those that consume it. I don't think anyone here would consider this water as acceptable. This one's better. Since starting the petition, many of the conversations and comments I have received from Pasadena residents regarding the water in our schools are similar. Most frequent comment has been that water was like that when I went to school there. I can't believe they haven't fixed it yet. Or, it's still like that? Numerous fixes have been tried over the years, costing millions of county taxpayer dollars, but the issue remains. Sadly, all these years have passed, and our children and staff have not had palatable water to drink unless they brought it to school themselves. Instead of spending the money on fixing and flushing and testing well water several times a week, which obviously has not resolved the problem, we request the board to provide funding to our schools for continual replenishment of clean and clear water cooler water for our students and staff within the Chesapeake Cluster and Complex. Current estimate is approximately $3 a bottle, 120 bottles a month, which is like $3,600 per 10-month period, for 1,100 CBMS students. Doing so will show the school system's commitment to health and wellness at our school and a great way to wrap up National Nutrition Month. Increasing the availability of clean water provides the opportunity for children to drink more water during the hours they are in your care that ultimately make them healthier, alert, and ready to learn. It may even better our school climate survey results from 2015, where 55% of Chesapeake Bay Middle School responders felt the school was not clean or well-maintained. Thank you for your time.
Thank you. I have a question. Do we know if the county has any plans to extend the county water to you guys so that the well water isn't an issue?
I do not know. I do know that, I don't know for a fact, but I have been told that there's a county line that runs down Mountain Road all the way to Gibson Island, and I've often wondered why we can't just tap into it.
Have you spoken to the county? Have you spoken to the county at all about that?
I have not, no.
Okay. Mr. Grannon?
Seems like you know a lot about the specifics of the water testing and treatment there. Has
I'm now getting up to speed.
That's why we're happy to have you, and we pay
about
the big bucks.
About a week ago, I had no idea we had 20 buildings on wells. So, and I've been here for 11 years.
Have you or Alex or anybody else on your team looked at adding an RO filter to that system? Maybe some kind of freestanding unit that could serve as a reverse osmosis filter for all the water for the school?
So I'm now going to have you go out to the treatment plant, and you can advise. So I don't know exactly all the things that have been tried. I know that it was in 2008 that the facility was redone to a cost of about $1.6 million. We had the water filtration system redone at the encouragement of MES and to update it. I don't know what was included in that and exactly what occurred. I wasn't at the meeting on Friday with the engineers and the plumbers and MES, so I don't know exactly what was suggested, but there were some suggestions about adding things to the pipes, both from the filtration part and then the point of entry into the three buildings, because our water, and this is something I didn't know, we own two water towers. As a school system, one at Southern High School and one at Chesapeake. And so the water is being filtered, pumped to the water tower, and then gravity is bringing it to the three buildings, the high school, the middle school, and then Bodkin Elementary. That's the complex that they're referring to, those three buildings. So I don't know. I can find out from the team exactly what's been suggested or tried up to this point.
I only ask because I'm on well water, and when I don't keep up with my salt delivery the way I'm supposed to, the iron goes up, and you take a shower, and you kind of smell like a penny. But
correct, right.
The drinking water is okay because we have an RO filter in our kitchen, and I noticed that whatever happens to our shower water doesn't happen to that water. So I was thinking maybe an RO filter might be rather, if we truly are spending a lot on frequent testing, make the investment for an RO filter, and that would just
absolutely
potentially do it.
I'll find out where we are. Absolutely.
Thank you, guys. The next three names I have: Linda Sawpaw, Corrine Frank, and Spear Lancaster.
Please take these remarks with a grain of salt because I'm so grateful for the kind and responsive way that you have responded to our first two speakers. My prepared remarks are a bit more impassioned than I would like them to be at this exact moment. Oh, and by the way, reverse osmosis does not work with iron. My name is Lindy Salpa. I own a home in Pasadena, and my children have been enrolled in Anne Arundel Public Schools for 7 years. I am here today to explain what a person with a chronic health condition, a varsity athlete, and a homeowner all share in common when they live and work in a community which says it is okay for school children to drink brown water, and that is stigma. It doesn't take much for a child to experience real or perceived stigma in today's culture, and the repercussions of childhood stigmas can be devastating and pervasive. There are specific groups of people in the Chesapeake Bay School Cluster who continue to be marginalized by Anne Arundel County Public Schools' refusal to provide equitable access to aesthetically adequate drinking water for the students and staff of Chesapeake Bay Schools. Imagine you are a child or adult with a medical concern which impacts your body's need for hydration. You show up every day to learn or teach, aspiring to perform to your highest potential despite fundamental health obstacles, and then you are told that the only water available to you is brown and malodorous. The child is more likely to internalize the situation and ask herself, what is it about me, an American student in a first world country, that is not good enough or deserving enough to have clear, safe water come out of the fountain? The most qualified and talented educators may begin sending out resumes. School culture is affected by the revolving door talent pool. On a different area of the spectrum, we might find our prep athletes and coaches. When teams from other schools visit for competitions, they are shocked to have to fill their water coolers with brown water. Our prep athletes and coaches notice, and maybe they're embarrassed. Maybe this embarrassment has an indiscernible effect on performance. Maybe our teams visit another school for a match 8 miles away that has sensors with special water bottle filling stations that measure how many ounces they drink. They might ask themselves, why doesn't the school board believe that we deserve the same clear water available in the rest of the county? Lastly, the homeowners who purchased homes in Pasadena in good faith that their children would have equitable access to appealing drinking water as part of their educational opportunities are marginalized when they need to move or retire to downsize, and their sale price is impacted because young families who research the school cluster discover the brown well water situation. The price issue has a chilling effect on their financial future and retirement. Please pay for our Pasadena students to drink safe bottled water while you reinvestigate flushing filtration strategies and other strategies. Thank you.
Could I have you guys look at this? I only have one copy. My name is Corinne Frank, and I am the mother of a kindergartner, Bodkin. My son, Cullen, just turned 6 in February. Recently, I've been made aware of the state of the drinking water. It is not clean, nor is it palatable. I have questioned many elected officials this week, and they have assured me that it is safe. And while I am relieved that they are not trying to intentionally poison my child, I think it's obvious that in a civilized society, clean water is expected, and especially for children. I've been to Mexico, and even there, I was provided with clean and palatable water. As this is the first year my child has been in public school, I did not know the quality of the water before this year and how long it has been an issue. I only recently moved into the Bodkin School District, and I can assure you that the reputation of this school was a very large selling point. After I discovered this petition, I discussed it with Cullen, and he said there were some days that he had nothing more to drink than his chocolate milk at lunch. As a parent, my heart aches. How could my baby just starting school be suffering from thirst in this country? The times that he would tell me, "Mommy, you forgot to fill my water bottle," I just assumed that he was reminding me because that's what he likes to do, and that there was a cooler readily available for him to use. Cullen had surgery on March 6th, and Monday was his first day back. The first time I sent my son to school knowing about this problem. His discharge papers have in bold type and been underlined. I didn't underline it, Johns Hopkins did. Encourage your child to drink. Notice there are 2 exclamation points. It then repeats, drink plenty of fluids. I cannot even describe the anger that I felt when sending him to school knowing what awaited him. CHS had water coolers when I was in school, and it never crossed my mind that they would remove them. Who made this decision to remove clean water from a child's school, knowing that dirty, unpalatable water was now the only option? This seems completely unethical, and I know that none of you were on the board 20 years ago, but somebody made that decision. I urge this board to please resolve this problem and give us water coolers before undertaking other projects like digital water bottles or 15 extra minutes of student sleep. I honestly have to say that I am very impressed by his school. I had many reservations sending to Cullen, sending Cullen to public school, but Bodkin has surpassed my expectations. I am requesting that you support my son and you support his school. Clean water, not just safe water, is a right to life. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. It's great to be here. I was visiting today with our community partnership director over at our office in Laurel, and he was telling me about a program called the Cultural Fest, which is coming up on April the 1st. And it's something we've done now for 5 years, and it's just really unique. And he said, you know, I'm going to send a mail out. I said, it'd be too late. So he asked me if I would come over. And also, I brought you over a recent copy of our quarterly magazine that we're putting out. And in here is all the data on the CSP schools, new math team, and lots of other things that I think you'll find very interesting. This cultural fest, by the way, will be held in Upper Marlboro, Maryland, at our CMIT South School. And we have over 100,000 square feet, so we've got over 100 different booths that will be set up in the hallways by parents from all over the world with their foods and their particular cultural artifacts and so forth and so on. Last year we had over 500 people show up. This year we expect at least 700 to show up. And we'd like to personally invite you to come over and visit with us if you get a chance. I will be there, of course, for the whole time, but it starts around 12 o'clock and goes till 4. So if you just drop in for an hour or so, we'd be just pleased to have you come over and look at it. Other than that, I just want to tell you that our robotics team has just about aced a test. The math team, 12 years in a row, number one. The kids are doing well. We thank you for all the help and support, and hope we keep rolling for you. So that's about it. No bad news. All good news. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I don't know.
Did you all get?
We do. We have them right up here.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
By the way, that's Mark's phone number. If you want to call and if you have any questions, he'd be glad to talk with you.
I just have one last card, Wanda Brown, or unless there's anyone else who'd like to come address the board at this time.
Hello, my name is Wanda Brown. I am a grandparent of three grandchildren that attend Bates Middle School, and they are walkers. And it is a very dangerous world we're living in now. My grandchildren have to pass three major hotels to get to school. They have no crossing guard, and there's been many incidents of crimes in the areas of shootings the time that the kids get out of school. There's a high, Maryland is very high. I have two granddaughters as well as a grandson. Maryland is very high on the list. There's always a teenager missing female in Maryland. We're very high on the list for sex trafficking. There's always a female missing. It's very dangerous. I don't want to be a statistic. So the children need a bus. It's not safety. And I don't know what it's going to take for someone to listen and get it done. It's been too many incidents, and they have no bus. There's a bus on Tyler Avenue that is closer to Bates than the kids on Clay Street. It's a risk, even with a weather factor, that they have to walk. And I'm sure everyone, safety should be a major issue, and at the top of the list, there's been many incidents involving children in schools in this day and time. And no one wants to be a statistic, and I know I don't. And I'm here representing the parents, the children of the area. They definitely need a bus. There is, you know, it's too much going on.
Could you do me a favor and put the area, the cross streets that you would need the bus at? It wasn't on your card.
Okay. Yes.
Thank you.
All right. Is there anyone like to respond?
We don't
comment.
We don't typically comment. We would just take your address and look it up.
Thank you.
Is there anyone else that would like to address the board at this time? Okay. We'll move on to consent items. We have 16 items 4.01 to 16, mostly for Arnold Elementary School and Manor View. Arnold Elementary School's replacement and Manor View's revitalization, along with broadband business, internet services, fire alarm replacements, Taverna Park, and Annapolis Solar Park power purchase. Do I have a motion to bundle items 4.01 to 4.16 and move them from information to action? Do I have a second? All those in favor? We now have an action item. Dr. Arlotto, your recommendation.
Yes, ma'am. I recommend that the board approve contracts as listed on today's agenda as 4.01 through 4.16.
Is there any board discussion? Is there any public comment? All those in favor? Motion passes 6-0. The next action item is 5.01, administrative personnel appointments, and we do not have any this evening. Item 5.02. is the policy revision first reading, employee use of social media policy GAOO, and we have a presentation.
Good evening. For the record, Jeanette Ortiz, Legislative and Policy Council. The Office of the Deputy Superintendent brings policy GAOO, employee use of social media, to you for first reading. This policy was last revised on April 17th, 2013. The updated policy provides guidance on the use of social media by AACPS employees. The policy will be posted on our website for 30 days for public comment. I can answer any questions you may have.
Mrs. Birch?
Typically, we have definitions for words that are used in our policy. I feel like in this one, we're actually making policy in our definitions. And that concerns me a little bit. Like in number 3, personal social media presence, it actually says what you can and can't do as related to a personal social media presence. So sometime before the next reading, could we look at it and make sure that we're not making policy in definitions, but the definitions are just definitions? Does that make sense?
It does make sense. This is a conversation that we had at the policy committee meeting.
Okay. Yes. And did they not agree with what I'm
saying? Well, the definitions weren't in the policy, and they asked us to put them in the policy.
Correct. Okay, but even if it was in the regulation, the definition should not be specifying a rule. It should only be saying what the word means. It shouldn't be saying the employee is not authorized to communicate, because that's a rule in a definition.
We'll take a look at it.
Yep. So, yeah.
Is there any public comment on this item? All right, this will go on the internet for 30 days.
For 30 days, correct. Yes.
Item 5.03 is an information item, policy first reading, student use of social media, JCCC.
The Office of the Deputy Superintendent brings policy JCCC, student use of social media, to you for first reading. The policy was last revised on April 18th. 2013. The updated policy provides AACPS students guidance on appropriate conduct when using social media. The policy will be posted on our website for 30 days for public comment. I can answer any questions you may have. So, yep, we will look at that as well.
Is there any public comment on this item? All right, that'll be up for 30 days.
Yes, correct.
The third first reading we have tonight is item 5.04, Student Assembly Programs for Political Candidates, IKP.
The Office of School Performance brings policy IKB, Student Assembly Programs for Political Candidates, to you for first reading. This policy was last revised on May 20th, 1991. The updated policy provides guidance regarding the participation of elected officials and political candidates in events at AACPS public school facilities. The policy will be posted online on our website for 30 days for public comment, and I can answer any questions you may have.
No board questions. Is there any public comment? All right. This will be up for 30 days?
Yes, correct.
Then we have two policy revisions that are up for a vote, third reading. Item 5.05, tutoring for pay, GBO. Dr. Arletto, your recommendation.
Yes, ma'am. I recommend board approval of policy GBO, subject to final correction for style and format.
So moved.
Second. Mrs. Summer?
So this policy very specifically deals with tutoring for pay, not for any other outside work that a teacher does.
Correct.
So it wouldn't, so for instance, for our coaches, it wouldn't affect outside coaching or anything, or this is solely for academic tutoring? Am I correct in that?
Correct,
yes. It's that specific. Okay.
Mrs. Birch.
At some point, I realize it's not completely related to this, we may want to look at the activities of our coaches as they relate to their students who are on their teams and their activities for pay related to those students outside of the school system.
We will
because we've been getting complaints.
Okay. We can look at that.
Okay. Is there any public comment on this item? All those in favor? Are you in favor? Terry? No? Eric? Okay. Opposed? Motion passes 5-1. And then we have policy KI, procedures for responding to Maryland public records request, item 5.06. This is an action item. Dr. Arletto, your recommendation.
Yes, ma'am. I recommend board approval of policy KI as subject to final correction for style and format.
So moved. Second.
I don't have any board comments or questions. Do I have any public comment? All those in favor? Motion passes 6-0. Thank you. Mr. Gilliland?
Thank you, Madam President. I'm sorry. We were engaged in an off-the-cuff conversation over here. No, it's on topic, but I was distracted. Forgive me for just a moment. I just wanted to say, just as a follow-up to what I said at the last meeting back on March 1st, that I do, on the tutoring for pay policy, I support the spirit and what I believe to be the intent of that policy. My concerns were just around some of the issues that could arise when teachers are working second jobs for some of the academic learning centers. I referenced some during the last meeting, and again, that was my concern, not necessarily the spirit of that policy. So I'm sorry I missed the chance to comment at the appropriate time.
And I also failed to acknowledge that Maria and Patty are not here this evening. Every time I'm counting votes, they are both out of town tonight. Item 5.07 is an information to action item, items of legislation. Do I have a motion to move this from information to action?
So moved.
All those in favor? We now have an action item, and you'll be going through a few more pieces of legislation. We're almost done.
This should be the last action items that the board will need to take on legislation. It's been a very busy legislative session. So we will jump right into Section 1 pieces of legislation where we are requesting the board to take action. The first bills are House Bill 1082, Senate Bill 1060, Heroin and Opioid Education and Community Action Act of 2017, or the Start Talking Maryland Act. This bill does a lot regarding heroin and opioid education in the state of Maryland, but we will focus on the provisions which specifically relate to school systems. Those provisions would require at the State Board of Education to expand an existing program to encompass drug addiction prevention education in public schools that specifically includes heroin and opioid addiction and prevention. It would require each local Board of Education to establish a policy requiring each public school to store naloxone and authorize a trained school nurse to administer it. The bill would require each local Board of Education to hire a community action official or regional community action official and require the governor to include a general fund appropriation of at least $3 million in the fiscal 2019 budget for MSDE to award grants to local boards of education to implement the bill's policy and training requirements. AACPS supports the intent of these bills as we have been a leader in this area. However, we propose several amendments to the legislation to ensure that local boards of education can help to implement a successful program. AACPS recommends the following amendments. Add language identifying health personnel and staff as there are schools that do not have school nurses. So specifically, the language in the bill right now just talks about school nurses, and not all schools have an actual school nurse. Add language to identify the role of county health departments in some local school systems, like AACPS, where school nurses are employees of the county health department. Remove all references to community action official and place the identified responsibilities with the county health departments. Define proper emergency follow-up procedures. Clarify that instruction delivered in grade bands, third through fifth grades, shall be done via instructional materials to parents or guardians. This will allow local boards of education to determine the appropriate curriculum for the middle school and high school students. And we recommend that the board support this legislation with the proposed amendments. So
moved. Any board questions or comments? Any public comment? All those in favor of supporting this with amendments? All right, motion passes 6-0.
The next bill, House Bill 1145, Public School Employee Whistleblower Protection Act. This bill would place prohibitions on a public school employer from taking or refusing to take certain personnel actions as reprisal against a public school employee because the employee discloses or threatens to disclose unlawful behavior. The bill provides information, the employee provides information or testifies for an investigation of unlawful behavior or objects to or refuses to participate in unlawful behavior. The bill would also provide for protections of an employee in specific instances. House Bill 1145 is unnecessary as employees can currently report issues to their supervisors or report such information to the AACPS fraud hotline. Additionally, this bill infringes upon the superintendent's authority to assign and transfer staff. The bill is not aligned with the current State Whistleblower Act, and it singles out school employees. We recommend that the board oppose this legislation.
Any board questions or comments? Any public comment? I think the only thing we noted when we were going through this at MABE was we don't want a separate bill. We want them, if we're going to do this, put the public school employees under the state whistleblower protection.
Yes, and that conversation has been folks have had this conversation with the bill sponsor and committee members in that Maryland currently has a state whistleblower protection act, but it only covers state employees. And so if the committee has the will to move this bill forward, that it should be aligned with current state law and it should apply to all employees, not simply school employees, but county and local employees as well. So that information MABE has shared and others with the committee.
And we're not saying we don't want to protect whistleblowers. We're saying
exactly, yes. It's just
we need to have one law.
Correct. There are inconsistencies with what's been proposed and what's in current statute.
Okay. All those in favor of opposing a separate law? Motion passes 6-0.
The next bill, House Bill 1305, Labor and Employment Payment of Wages Minimum Wage. This might sound a little familiar, but it's a little different bill. This bill would increase the state's minimum wage to $12.50 an hour beginning July 1st, 2019. This proposed legislation would have a significant fiscal impact on AACPS in the middle of some financially difficult times for us. We currently have about 700 employees who earn less than the wage that would be required under this bill. As I mentioned, this is similar to a previous bill the board opposed, and we recommend that the board oppose this legislation as well.
Do we have a motion to oppose? Any board questions or comments? The prior bill was for $15, correct?
Yes, correct. The prior bill would have an incremental increase to $15 an hour. This bill would just begin at $12.50 beginning July 1st, 2019, but still a significant impact and a change from the current minimum wage and what we pay these 700 employees.
Is there any public comment on this item? All those in favor of opposing this bill? All those opposed? Motion passes 5-1.
The next bill, House Bill 1310, Education Ethical Special Education Advocate Certificate Program. This bill would require MSD to establish a voluntary ethical special education advocate certificate program within MSD by July 1st, 2018. The bill specifies qualifications that applicants must meet for certification, as well as the process and requirements for renewal of certification. AACPS believes that this bill could ensure that special education advocates have the necessary training and certification to properly support parents and students. However, we do propose some amendments. We propose that the bill also add a face-to-face component to the training, which would allow for greater opportunity for learning. We propose a clarification on how good moral character can be determined. The bill requires that a candidate have good moral character, but that's not defined. And also, we propose that a mechanism for others to express concern to MSDE when a certificated advocate is not acting professionally or in the best interest of students and families. We recommend that the board support this bill with the proposed amendments.
So moved.
Any board questions or comments? Any public comment? All those in favor of supporting with amendments? Motion passes 6-0.
The next bill is House Bill 1476 and Senate Bill 867, Workers' Compensation, Failure to Report Accident or Action to Deter or Dissuade from Filing a Claim Penalties. These bills would subject a manager, an executive, or an officer of the employer to imprisonment not exceeding 6 months for deterring or dissuading a covered employee from filing a workers' compensation claim. The legislation exposes AACPS to additional legal action, which could result in greater expenses on litigation. We also have concerns with the increased penalties in the bill, most notably the fact that this would not be a jailable offense, and we recommend that the board oppose these bills.
I just have a question. You might not know the answer to this, but if I'm an employee, I'm injured on the job, and I fill out my workers' comp paperwork, and my employer doesn't want to file it, isn't there a way for me to go and around them and submit my claim? Is there some kind of hotline?
Yes, there's a current process and procedures in place. I don't have the detailed information, but can certainly provide that to you. But there are certainly ways for employees to go ahead and
So if my employer is doing claim. This, I can still get my claim in?
Yes, okay. Correct.
Any public comment? All those in favor of opposing this bill? Motion passes 6-0.
The next bill, House Bill 1486, Teachers and Teacher Preparation Programs, Research-Based Reading Instruction. This bill would require the Professional Standards and Teacher Education Board to require teaching candidates applying for a certificate to teach students with disabilities as a reading specialist, as a reading teacher, or kindergarten through fifth grade to successfully pass a written test of research-based reading instruction. AACPS opposes teacher certification requirements being mandated or controlled by the General Assembly. The current Maryland State Teacher Certification requirements require teacher candidates to pass Praxis 1, and all teachers have to have 12 semester hours in specialized courses. We recommend that the board oppose this bill.
Mrs. Huber.
Can I just say that I find this bill to be insulting to teachers? I mean, and MSD. I mean, we already have these qualifications in place, and to assume that we have reading teachers that don't know phonics and don't know how to teach is just insulting, and yes, I oppose this bill.
Mrs. Birch.
I just want to say, because I did sit on the task force I forget what the whole name was, but it was about dyslexia. And that's where this came from. And I think that there probably was no intent to be insulting, but I think that there is certainly an impression from parents of children who are dyslexic that many elementary school teachers don't recognize the signs of dyslexia. And I think that's what they were hoping to go for. I disagree with legislation as being the way to accomplish that, but I understand their frustration when they had children in school for years and no one ever, I mean, they just knew that the kid had a problem, but no one ever figured out what the problem was. So they're looking for a solution, but they haven't quite figured out what the right fixes yet, I don't think. But I think that's what they're trying to do. They're trying to make things better for these kids who've made it through years and years of school, and no one ever diagnosed them with what their actual issues were. So, you know, maybe don't be as insulted as you are. But again, I don't know that legislation, we don't want every issue to be decided by the General Assembly. They're exactly. Not educators. They're not the ones to decide how things should happen in, you know, in our schools or in schools of education. There are other people who are better at making those determinations.
Right.
And I think that's the important issue here.
I can say that maybe the intent was good on that, but also diagnosis of dyslexia is not necessarily going to be improved by mandating a reading instruction. That is a there's some different things that we can do to address that. And if that is the intent of this, the message that comes across is that our teachers don't know what they're doing. And I don't believe they should be mandating our curriculum or our instruction for our teachers. And I certainly don't want them insulting our teachers for their capabilities.
There's another bill that was introduced. We didn't weigh in on it. It would just require MSD to look at addressing dyslexia in schools, which we probably prefer something like that to pass because it doesn't put any requirements on the school systems or the teachers. So that bill hearing happened, I think Tuesday, and received a good bill hearing. So perhaps that will move and this one won't.
Is there any public comment on this?
Pam Bukowski, I'm a speech pathologist at Southern Middle, Southern High in Phoenix. Speaking as an individual, I too am insulted. Everybody can't know everything about everything. That's why we have specialists. And that's why those of us that are specialists have specific training to allow us to administer assessments, to do the observations, to be part of a team that's able to diagnose, you know, issues, learning disabilities, anything that may impede our students' progress and their inability to access their education. So I do urge you to oppose it. Thank you, Mrs. Hummer.
All those in favor of opposing? Motion passes 6-0.
And our last bill, House Bill 1603, Education, County Boards of Education, Removal of County Superintendents. This bill would allow a County Board of Education to remove a superintendent. Under existing law, the State Superintendent of Schools may remove a County Superintendent for immorality, misconduct in office, insubordination, incompetency, or willful neglect of duty. AACPS opposes efforts by the General Assembly to alter the current process for the removal of a county superintendent. House Bill 1603 is contrary to the current and longstanding practices of the state and eliminates due process and checks and balances. The State Board of Education addressed this issue in Metz versus Prince George's County Board of Education, where the State Board noted that the state superintendent has the final authority on these matters. We recommend that the board oppose this bill.
Second. We did not submit this bill.
No.
Just for the record.
Coming back to work.
I do have to say, you know, there's similar situation in place for removing a board member, and I think we all would like the protection of an added layer of an impartial party who can take a look at a decision that people might be making out of anger or spite. So I definitely will be opposing this bill. Any public comment on this item? All those in favor of opposing? Motion passes 6-0.
Okay, that's
we might have made it through.
Yay.
Another General Assembly.
Yes, and I will provide...
At least taking positions.
Yes, and I will start
and
providing status updates on
the
bill.
Yeah, we get
bill.
To find the results.
Yes.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Item 5.08 is an action item on the Annapolis Peninsula redistricting. Dr. Oletto, your recommendation.
Yes, ma'am. I recommend that the board hold separate votes on each of the three portions of the Annapolis Peninsula redistricting plan, subject to testimony at its public hearing.
Do I have a motion? Are there any board questions or comments on this item? Is there any, Mrs. Birch?
I just wanted to say that, you know, thank you for thinking of that, because that could have been disastrous if we had decided not to do one portion. And then the whole plan would have gone down if we decided that, you know, what we wanted to do in 2019, 2020 wasn't going to happen. And then none of the redistricting could have happened because of the way we had structured it. So thank you very much for bringing this back to us in this format so that we could appropriately split it up and make the decisions as they should be, as separate decisions.
Is there any public comment? All those in favor? Motion passes 6-0. And just a reminder that we will be taking those three plans to a redistricting hearing on April 3rd at 6 p.m. at Annapolis High School. Our last item is a review item, 6.01, the monthly financial status report and FY 2017 revenue and projections. There's no presentation. Does anyone have a question on this item? Is there any public comment? So you don't even have to come and sit. All right, that concludes our meeting. I just have a couple of announcements. The next board policy committee meeting is Wednesday, March 29th at 1 p.m. I already mentioned the April 3rd redistricting hearing. The next board of education meeting is Wednesday, April 5th at 10 a.m. And the upcoming board budget committee meeting is Wednesday, April 19th at 4:30 p.m. And that concludes our meeting. Have a great evening.